was that the social safety net that we had would soon become overwhelmed by the level of demand that would be placed upon that. And even with the increased estimates of what we thought that demand would be, we saw it very quickly become very clear that the government's income support measures would need to be further enhanced. And so we came up with what has been, I think, and I think many others think, has been one of the key economic policies in its design that have protected Australian livelihoods and lives over the course of this past year. It was the combination of an enhanced social safety net, which was the COVID supplement, which was our first initiative to ensure that we strengthened the safety net upon which Australians would rely on. And then there was JobKeeper. JobKeeper, which effectively nationalised private sector payrolls to deliver a system of income support to a degree this country has never seen before in its history, and did so in a fair way, with the same payments to everybody that was affected, a very Australian way. And the combination of JobKeeper together with JobSeeker supplement ensured that Australians had the confidence and the certainty to move through what would have been the most uncertain period of their lives for most of them. Perhaps not Jane Malishak. I suspect she's seen some more uncertain times in her life, and that generation has. But for most of us, the most uncertain time in our lives. And those two measures came together to provide that emergency support. Now, we said it had to be targeted. We said it had to be time limited. There needed to be a clear path for how we would pursue this once the emergency situation had receded. At the end of next month, we will be in the position where JobKeeper expires, and we will be in the position where, under the legislation, the JobSeeker COVID supplement also expires. And the government has been working steadfastly as to the arrangements that will be in place after that point in time. Now, on Sunday, I said we had moved into a new chapter with the commencement of the vaccination program. I said that that would change how Australia was dealing with the pandemic. That is true for the economic supports and other measures that have been in place as emergency measures, as it is indeed true for the many responses put in place on restrictions and things of that nature. And that will continue to change over the course of year. But Sunday was a change day. Sunday was a day that Australia confidently moved into the next phase of how we fight this pandemic and we battle to secure the livelihoods and lives of Australians. And so, as we come into that next chapter, and by the end of next month, we will be well into that, as tens of thousands, if not greater, will have been vaccinated by that point, and the National Cabinet will have met again, that we believed it was important that we show faith once again in our social safety net. What I mean by that is we are now confident that at the end of next month, that our social safety net can once again be able to provide the support it needs to Australians as we come out of the COVID-19 recession, for that social safety net to be there for them if they find themselves without work. But we've also formed the view that that base level of support that exists within our social safety net needs to be adjusted for the long term. So we are moving from short-term emergency measures to long-term arrangements now that people can rely on should they find themselves out of work. Now, we've still got a long way to go. We understand that. And that's why the Treasurer and I, on another occasion, will be making further announcements about what we'll be doing in other parts of the economy. But the truth is, the JobMaker hiring credit, that's in place. The tax cuts, they're in place. The instant expensing arrangements, they're in place. The bring forwards of infrastructure projects, they're in place. The economic recovery plan continues to roll out, but we change gears. And with that change of gears, what we are doing now is we are rebasing the JobSeeker payment to ensure that the long-term arrangements now are there for people to rely on should they find themselves out of work and to get the support they need when they're out of work. And that will lead to an increase of $50 per fortnight in that base payment. But as I'm sure Anne will set out to you, That is, of course, not the only payment that people receive when they're on JobSeeker. There's Commonwealth rent assistance, there's energy supplements, there's a range of other payments which increase the amount that someone will receive on a fortnightly basis by more than $150 extra a fortnight because of those additional supports. That's our social safety net. We are now moving. I said every day would become more normal. Moving back to a normal safety net arrangement is part of that normalising process, but we're ensuring that it's set at a base that we believe is appropriate going forward. Now, that puts the JobSeeker payment at 41.2% of the national minimum wage, which is commensurate with what it was during the time of the Howard government. It is true that this is one of the single, it is the single largest increase in the JobSeeker payments since the mid-80s, year on year. That is true. But I think the more relevant feature to focus on is what it is as a percentage of the national minimum wage. And this brings it up from 37.5% up to 41.2%. And that is commensurate with where it sat during that period of the Howard government. Now, social security payments, welfare support when people need it is something we strongly believe in. And at a cost of some $9 billion over the forward estimates, including the cost between now and the end of this year. That is a contract with Australians and Australian taxpayers. Australian taxpayers believe in this system. I believe in this system, and they know it's important for people who really need it, and particularly now. I mean, many people who may go onto this payment who have never been on it before in the months ahead, as there has been over the course of the last year. And what's important is the mutual obligation that we all have one to another in how our social safety net works. You know, every person we get in a job, they're better off and the country's better off. And so that remains our objective. If you're on JobSeeker, we will work night and day to get you off it and into a job. We have already seen 93% of the jobs come back into our economy. This is great progress, but there's so much more to do. And every person we get back off JobSeeker onto a job, that not only puts their household budget in a better position so they can have greater control over their own lives, that also supports the Australian people's budget, as expressed through the Australian government's budget. That moves someone from receiving taxpayer support to being a taxpayer. And that was the big game changer that actually enabled us to bring the budget back into balance prior to this pandemic. So with those rather lengthy introductory comments, I appreciate your patience. I'm going to ask Anne to take you through those changes. And for Michaelia, there are mutual obligation requirements here that we put into this arrangement, which are simply designed to do one thing, to help people get back into work.
Thank you very much, PM. Well, the package of measures that we're going to announce today are clearly about getting the balance right. We need to support people while they're looking for work. We need to create the incentives so people want to look for work, and we also have to remove the disincentives so that they're not disincentivised for work. But what we need to do is we need to ensure that we have a system that is fair and sustainable for the people who need it and the taxpayers who pay for it. As the Prime Minister said, this is the single biggest increase in unemployment benefits since 1986, with a $50 per fortnight increase. But in addition to that, we're also increasing the income-free area to $150 per fortnight for those people who are on JobKeeper and Youth Allowance Other, as opposed to those people who are on a student payment who already have a higher income-free area. What it does is it creates a greater incentive for people to put their toe in the water and test the job market, because we know that people who report earnings are twice as likely to transition off payment than those who don't report any earnings. As I said, the Prime Minister said, it comes at a $9 billion price tag. We are also will be extending a couple of temporary supports over the next 3 months, one of which is the ordinary waiting period. Currently, the ordinary waiting period is waived so that people who come onto payment don't have to wait for 1 week before they receive payment. And in recognition that we need to make the smoothest transition on the 31st of March to the 1st of April, that waiver will remain in place until the 30th of June. In addition to that, we will also maintain the accessibility to payment for people who are in isolation because they have COVID or because they're caring for somebody who has COVID. So this means 1.95 million Australians who are currently on working age payments will receive an increase of $50 per fortnight as of the 1st of April. This is single parents, this is young people, this is students as well as job keepers. And just as some statistics, that means 240,000 single parents with a child under the age of eight will receive a payment of $850.20 per fortnight. There will be a further 220,000 people who are over the age of 60 or who have a caring responsibility for a child over the age of eight who will receive a JobSeeker rate of $676.30, including the energy supplement. And when you consider there are a further 290,000 Australians on JobSeeker payment who also receive Commonwealth rent assistance, they will now receive $768.80 per fortnight. As I said, we want to make sure that people who are on payments experience firsthand the benefits of being on work by incentivising them to get back into the workforce. Certainly, there can be no doubt that this is the single largest extension or measure that we've put in place for those 1.95 million Australians who currently are on working age payments. And we've made sure that in doing this that we have balanced their support, incentive to work, and making sure that we have a sustainable welfare system into the future, so that not only today but into the future we'll have a system that can support people who need it. We will continue to make sure that our welfare system is targeted and comprehensive with a range of supports that recognise the individual needs of Australians who need our support at this time. Thank you.
Michaelia.
Thank you, Prime Minister, and thank you, Minister Rustin. And today the package we bring before you also entails a strengthening of mutual obligation requirements. As the Prime Minister has said, the best form of welfare is a job. And our commitment as a government is to do everything that we can to get people who are on welfare into a job. And as such, we are reinstating mutual obligation requirements, but we're also strengthening them. Last year, as a result of COVID-19, we did have to put a pause on mutual obligation requirements. But now in 2021, and in particular with 93% of the jobs lost during COVID returning to the economy, and with our focus on our post-pandemic economy, it's time to reinstate mutual obligation. What does that actually entail? In the first instance, there will be a requirement for job seekers to attend face-to-face appointments with their providers. They currently do not have to do that as a result of COVID-19. We are also going to increase the number of job searches a job seeker does per month. As a result of COVID, they were reduced to 8. We will progressively move that to 15 job searches a month, and then as of the 1st of July, 20 job searches a month, which is what it was before the pandemic hit. We will also, after 6 months of being on welfare, require people to enter into an intensive training stage. In other words, we're going to give them the best chance they can to do a short course to enhance their skills or to do some work experience. If they then do remain on welfare, that will give them an even better chance of getting a job. So this will now occur at 6 months. You often hear, though, employers saying, Joe applied for a job, he was qualified for the job, or she, and they said no. What we will be doing for employers is introducing an employer reporting line so that if someone does apply for a job, they're offered the job and they're qualified for the job, but they say no, the employer will now be able to contact my department and report that person as failing to accept suitable employment. This will then mean that my department can follow up with that person, or alternatively, JobActive can follow up with that person to ascertain exactly why they said no to a suitable job. And in the event they do not have a valid reason, they will be breached for that. We will at the same time, though, be increasing the number of audits we do on our job providers. We need to ensure that our job providers are following up on our job seekers and ensuring that they are doing the right thing. Remember, this is all about getting people off welfare and into work. We currently undertake around 4% of the caseload by way of an audit. We will be increasing that to 10% of the caseload. We will also require all job seekers in Stream A Digital to now, prior to being able to get their welfare payment, to fill out their career profile. Currently, they don't have to do that. That type of information is instrumental in ensuring that we can properly match you, your skills and your career profile to a job in demand. This is all about acknowledging that if I am receiving welfare, I have obligations to do everything I can to get into a job. But this is also the government's commitment to all Australians. The best form of welfare is a job, and we will do everything that we can to move people from welfare into work.
So our social safety net is a social contract. It's a contract between the government and Australians, but it's also a contract between Australians. And what you've heard just announced today is about getting the balance of that right.
Prime Minister, even the best plans need a stable government to implement it. Is your government stable? What assurances have you sought or received from Craig Kelly? And what is your plan with the Speaker of the House of Reps?
There are no changes that are required as a result of the announcement you've heard earlier today, and you've heard that directly from the member for Hughes. The government will continue to function as it has successfully, and as the government has led Australia through the worst situation we've seen since the Second World War. We will continue to do so undistracted, and we'll be able to do so with the support of the Parliament from the very undertakings that the member for Hughes has indicated himself publicly.
He has resigned, Prime Minister.
Authority. What does it say about your authority over your party room? Prime Minister, what does it say about your authority over your party room when you lose one of your own members to the crossbench, and this is an individual who owes you? You saved his pre-selection.
In relation to the member for Hughes, to Craig, we had a discussion a couple of weeks ago, as you'll be aware. I set out some very clear standards, and he made some commitments that I expected to be followed through on. He no longer felt that he could meet those commitments, but I can tell you, my standards don't change.
Prime Minister, where did Craig Kelly tell you he was going to quit the Liberal Party? Did he seek any guarantee about his pre-selection from you? Is there anything he asked you to do that you would not offer him?
No, I learned it at the same time as he announced it to the party room.
Had you lost confidence in Mr Kelly, his ability to be a Liberal MP given his freelancing and also his ability to win pre-selection for the Liberal Party for Hughes?
Well, the matter of his pre-selection is a matter for him in the Liberal Party, but that is no longer an issue because he's resigned from the Liberal Party. But I say what I just said to you before. I set out very clear expectations on a range of matters that I expected Craig to follow through on. He'd given me a number of commitments in relation to that. He no longer felt that he could meet those commitments, and as a result he's made his decision today, and by his own explanation he has said that his actions were slowing the government down, and he believed the best way for him to proceed was to remove himself from the party room and provide the otherwise support to the government so it could continue to function as it so successfully has, which he says is something that he remains committed to. And so I would expect him to conduct himself in that way.
You've got down to 75 on the floor now, so you've lost your working majority. Kelly, Mr Kelly's promised you or guaranteed supply and confidence, but what about your legislative agenda going forward? Is it going to make you rethink plans and something like the energy bill, which you're not sure what's going on with at the moment? You now need a crossbencher for every vote, effectively, if you're opposed by Labor. Are you going to have to rethink in the next 12 months?
No. No.
Seen down in the office with Craig Kelly. Do you have any expectation that Craig Kelly will actually join the Nationals? And given that he's defied your request, as you described in various ways in relation to alternative COVID cures, do you have any concerns he's just going to end up with the National Party room?
No, I don't, but that's really a matter for others.
A senior member in Mr Kelly's office, staff member rather, is under police investigation amid allegations of inappropriate work conduct. There is actually an AVO taken out against that staff member. Would you expect that staff member no longer be employed as a member of the government? And did that have any? Are you concerned that Mr Kelly chose to keep that staff member on board while those investigations took place?
I have long expressed to Mr Kelly my concerns about that staff member, and he has long understood what my expectations were about how he would deal with that matter.
Prime Minister, you said at the start of this press conference, nothing will distract me or my government from my pledge to save lives and save livelihoods. Are sexual assault allegations a distraction for your government, and will you commit to setting up a dedicated support line for staff who work for the government and opposition to report sexual assault?
No, they're not a distraction. I do not consider those a distraction. I can consider those a very important issue, and so I wouldn't accept that suggestion for a second. They're important issues, and we are addressing them, and the process that we're engaged in a multi-party way, which Minister Birmingham is leading that process now, and I look forward to that process being settled very, very soon. I don't want to preempt the recommendations of that inquiry, but I've already moved this week to ensure there is additional counselling support that's available to staff right now. I think one of the things we've learned is that both the awareness of support services and indeed the delivery of those support services is coming under a lot of scrutiny. And today, Celia updated the party room on the processes I'd engaged, asked her to engage in. She has recommended to me, together with Anne Webster from the Nationals, that that process be consolidated into this broader multi-party process. And I agree with that, and our leadership agreed with that today. And so I think that will mean that that process, you know, is the single process for dealing and allowing staff and others, former staff and others, to engage with the process finally agreed between all the parties. So I consider it a serious issue. I consider it a significant issue. It's something we have to deal with, and I am dealing with, but it also won't be dealt with at the expense of what Australians expect me to deal with each other each and every day. And so the two will be done.
Prime Minister, what's the timeframe that you're considering for this independent inquiry that Simon Birmingham is setting up? Are you going to commit to making public the findings before an election is called? And will there be an interim report so that staff know that progress is being made on this issue?
Well, most of the answer to those questions are what has been discussed amongst the party leaders and together with Simon now. So I can't really preempt what they will agree and what they'll put forward. But it'd be my expectation that certainly any report of that body would be made public. That would be my expectation, and when it would be completed by, I would hope that they could proceed as quickly as possible, but as thoroughly as possible, and I would hope that that would be a reasonable time frame, and I would expect that to be well in advance of the next election. So that would be my hope and expectation, and I suspect that that view would be shared by the other party leaders representing the many parties that are in our parliament.
A follow-up on that question. What about the Phil Gaetjens review into your own office? Mm. Will that be made public? If not, why not?
Well, I haven't said it won't. I've simply said that I'm waiting for Phil to provide that report, and that I'll give further advice on that once I receive it.
Prime Minister, just
on the matter of Brittany Higgins and her alleged rape, can you explain why the alleged perpetrator's employment was terminated, apparently before the government knew that an alleged rape had taken place? Mm. And if you tell us it's because of a security breach, can you explain what was the security breach?
Well, it was because of a security breach. That was the reason for it. And it, as I understand it, it related to the entry into those premises. That's my understanding, but that's a matter of public record.
Welfare advocates seem to be saying that they think it's not enough. Can you explain how and why you reached the conclusion that this amount was enough?
Yeah, and you might wish to comment on this as well. 41.2% of the national minimum wage, which puts us back in the realm of where we had been previously. I mean, the indexation had been different to other payments, and as a result, it had fallen down to 37.5%. We had obviously taken advice about the level of the payment, and this puts it back, you know, comfortably within the middle of the range that had previously been in place. Now, I have no doubt that whatever rate you set the payment, there will always be suggestions by some that it should be more. There'll be some who'll suggest it should be less. And that's why a government has to exercise judgment in getting that balance right, but not just in the setting of the payment, but also the conditions that sit around the provision of that payment and that is seeking to support people not to have to rely on that payment and to be able to get them back into work. And so they were the matters that we considered as a government and took advice, obviously, but ultimately governments make these decisions, and we believe we've made a decision even though it comes at a considerable expense to taxpayers, some $9 billion, the final estimate will be confirmed in the budget later this year, taking into account all factors and the updated forecast that you'd expect in a budget. But what I do know is this, is every person we get back into a job means that will be a lesser cost to the taxpayer. And that's why the mutual obligation arrangement is so important. But I'll ask Em, she would like to comment further.
Yeah.
It as $4 a day, which doesn't seem very much.
Yes. Well, look, back to your primary question around, you know, the process, the comprehensive process that we've been through. And I mean, clearly, as I stated in my statement, we had to balance out, you know, three very strong interests that we had to balance. You know, one obviously is to make sure that we provide support to people who find themselves out of work. We needed to make sure that we created a system and improved a system so that the incentives to take up work were there and the disincentives were removed, and that's very much part of the package that Minister Cash has put forward. But we also need to make sure that not just that it is a fair system, but it's a sustainable system, because we have to look after the people that need the system, but we also have to understand that it's paid for by taxpayers and it needs to be sustainable into the future. So we certainly have drawn on the experience that we've seen over the last 12 months. We've had elevated levels of payment to people who are on unemployment benefits, recognising that back in March and April the jobs market closed and the support was needed. But you know, as the economy is recovering, as the jobs market is improving, you know, certainly we need to make sure that we've got the right incentives for people to go back to work. But our comprehensive and targeted welfare system has not changed. People who need additional assistance because of their circumstances, people who are renting who get Commonwealth rent assistance, people who have children who get support through the family tax benefit system. But there are a myriad of other supplements and allowances that are paid to people that recognise the range of individual circumstances, and all of these factors have been considered in coming up with the rate, along with you know, the other indicators that the Prime Minister's outlined in his response.
Hang on a sec. Just to illustrate the point that you're making, a single person on the JobSeeker payment, inclusive of the increase anticipated because of the indexation in March, will now see their payment increase, the base payment increase from $570.80 to $620.80. That's inclusive of the indexation. It actually goes from $565.70 to $620.80. On top of that, if they're receiving Commonwealth rent assistance, that payment would increase to $760.40. And on top of that, the average value of standalone supplements, the energy supplement and so on, is an additional $13.03. So the suggestion that anyone who was on JobSeeker is simply on that payment alone and there aren't additional supports that are provided is not correct. There are additional supplements, as you can see there, to the tune of some $150 in addition to that base rate, which would be a common experience of most people who would be on that payment.
The expectations you expected of Mr Kelly's behaviour to save the government, you know, when you spoke to him a few weeks ago?
Well, I was speaking to him at that time about his support for the government's position on health matters, and I've consistently outlined to him the matter in relation to the staff member that was referred to in an earlier question.
Be simply absorbed into larger budget deficits, and does the minister expect that there will be savings from the tighter mutual obligation requirements?
Well, and answer the first question, and can address the other matters. Well, at present, that goes directly onto the budget bottom line, and that is where it would be absorbed. Well, no, I'm saying that I'll let Anne address those issues.
Well, clearly the main objective of making sure of all of the programs that this government has been putting forward have been focused on jobs. And of course, by getting somebody off welfare and into a job, there clearly is a saving, not only a saving because their lives are better because they're no longer relying on welfare, but they're into the jobs market and they're paying tax. But there is no savings provisions considered in this particular package, but clearly we hope that it works well enough that we do have significant savings in the process of doing it.
Senator Cash?
Yep.
So in October of 2019, the Defence Minister Linda Reynolds called your Chief of Staff to alert him to a media inquiry regarding an incident that had happened in that office. What did the Defence Minister tell your Chief of Staff? He then spoke to you, and then you then spoke to Brittany, where you were very supportive and hugged her and told her you would look after her. If you maintain that you didn't know it was a sexual assault, what did you think you were talking about?
Well, that was exactly what the Defence Minister said to my Chief of Staff. There was merely a media inquiry. I then spoke to my Chief of Staff and Brittany together. Brittany was actually concerned about the media inquiry and that she was a media advisor and she was going to have people inquiring about her. She was very concerned that she was going to become a story. It was actually about her job and nothing more. I have absolutely not. And I have made my position very clear in the Senate.
I'm sorry, I've got an international call I have to make.